All right, guys, so let us start this chapter, waves. So we'll quickly have a small discussion on what is waves and so on and so forth. Then we can start the topic. Write down waves. Now, when you hear the word waves, what comes in your mind, honestly? What is the first thing that comes? Ocean, up and down, sound, okay? Sound comes in your mind. Okay. Fine, so these are the things that come in our mind. So let us take an example of water ripple. Do you think water ripple is a wave? Do you think water ripple is a wave? Water ripple is an example of a wave. So if water ripple is an example of a wave, then how it is created? How the water ripple is created? Can you tell me how you create water ripples? Throw a pebble, throw a stone. Okay. So what does stone does? What is stone doing when you throw it on the water? Disturb the water. Okay. So basically, it doesn't matter whether you throw a stone or from your hand only you do it. There should be some disturbance. Okay. Disturbance is created at one location. And what is happening to the disturbance then? When you create a disturbance in one of the location, then that disturbance propagates, isn't it? Suppose right now disturbance is here only. This location has no idea that there is a disturbance over there, but this disturbance will travel and reach here also. Okay. So this is a wave. All right. So if we crudely, you know, tell what is a wave. Wave is nothing but wave is a disturbance that travels from one location to the other. Okay, so this is the crude definition of what is a wave. Now, if it is a disturbance, will this disturbance have some sort of energy or not? Everyone, a disturbance has energy or not? Disturbance will have energy. Okay, so many a times when I say that disturbance is what is traveling from one location to other, the importance is not that clear. Okay. So rather than calling it a disturbance, we could call it energy. Okay. So energy is transferred from one location to the other. Fine. And this energy can have information within it. Okay, I'll talk about it in some time. This energy can create force. Fine. So, bhai, this disturbance which has energy is getting transmitted from one location to the other, then I mean, how it is different from a particle going from point A to point B? How it is different from that? Can anyone answer that? This object has gone from A to B. So the kinetic energy from here has gone there. So what is the difference between this situation and that situation? All of you, tell me. Okay. When a particle is going from A to B and a wave is going from A to B, is there any difference? Is there any difference? The water ripples when they are moving. What is happening? Concentric circles are there and they are expanding like that. Okay. When concentric circles are expanding, do you think water is receding? Do you think water is moving away and going further away from the disturbance? Is that is what happening? What do you think? When you disturb the water and you see that the disturbance created in a circle and circle expands. When circle expands, is water is also moving, residing? Water is moving or not? You're not understanding my question? Okay, my question is that when you throw stone, you see these concentric circles getting created and they are expanding. So when these concentric circles are expanding, is water also moving like this? That is my question. Is water also going like that? Okay, if you say yes, which some of you have said, then if I keep on throwing stone, the wherever I am throwing stone, the water will be gone and all the water will be at the corners. But that doesn't happen ever. Okay, so water is not moving. Get that? Water is not moving with the wave. All right, please understand that. Wave can use a medium like water to move forward, but the medium doesn't move with wave. Okay, so you need to get this very, very clearly that the medium is just like, you know, a means to transport the energy or the disturbance from one location to the other. Okay, have you seen the Diwali lights or any New Year lights wherein there are a lot of LED bulbs like that? If you put LED bulbs and sometimes you feel as if the light is, you know, traveling like that. Have you ever seen that? What LED does? The LED only does on and off and you feel as if the light is traveling like that. Have you ever seen that? Right? So exactly something like that is happening. What is happening? The medium, the particles of the medium, they are just oscillating. They are oscillating up and down. So you'll feel as if water is moving forward. But it is not water, is it? It is a disturbance that is moving forward. Okay. So keep that thing very, very clearly. We will come back to it again. Okay. But let me first classify a few things, that there are waves that require medium and some waves do not require a medium. All right. Have you done the waves introduction earlier ever in class 8, 9th somewhere? Or this is the first time? In 8th, okay. See, the thing is that you might have seen in your class 11th curriculum. This is the last chapter, okay? Before this chapter, can you recognize that everything was about matter? Everything. Mechanics is about how mass moves, how particle moves. Mechanical properties of matter, rigid body motion, simple harmonic motion of a mass, then properties of a mass, mechanical property of solid, mechanical properties of liquid, thermal property of the matter. So everything is about mass in class 11th. Okay. So you may not know, but in class 12th, everything is about charge. But there are few chapters which are disconnected. For example, in this chapter is not about mass. Getting it? So do not try to relate whatever you have learned already directly in this chapter, because whatever things you have learned is valid for the masses. What I'm telling you is that when, let's say, two particles are coming and hitting like this, what you do? You conserve momentum, right? You have coefficient of restitution and whatever you have. You conserve momentum when two particles come and hit like this. But when one wave meet the other wave like this, you can't conserve momentum. Okay, so you need to have something else, some other let's say principles you should have, some other way of dealing of how what will happen if one wave meets the other wave. Okay, so that is why I call that this chapter is different from your entire physics you have been learning till now in class 11th. Okay, so do not force yourself to apply things directly on this chapter. Okay. Doesn't the mass only collide? As in? Yeah, mass will collide. So when mass collide, when you can say when two masses meet, okay? Meeting and collision, just an English word, okay? So when two waves meet, you have a different way of dealing with it. And when two masses meet, you have two different ways of dealing with it. You have a different way of dealing with it, okay? That is what I'm saying here. Okay, so now waves, they're just the way waves move. There are two types of waves, okay? The wave which require medium to move, this require medium to move. This one doesn't require medium, okay? Doesn't require medium. What is the above one called, which require medium? This one is called, this is the mechanical wave, correct? This is a mechanical wave, and this is what? Electromagnetic waves. So this is what classification based on how wave travel. All right. So this EM wave, you will learn it in class 12th. Mechanical wave is there in 11th, okay? But of course, there are few basics and few fundamentals which are valid for EM wave as well as mechanical wave. So that is why the name of the chapter in class 11th is waves, so that we cover the basics, which is valid for both, and then we will talk about mechanical waves thereafter. Okay. Now, there is another way of classifying the waves. Write down. Classification based on how medium oscillates. Just now we discussed that the medium won't move with the wave, but medium is oscillating. Okay, so the way medium oscillates, you can discuss or you can classify based on that also. Okay, so waves can be of two types with respect to how the medium is behaving. Can you guess, anyone? You have already learned it in class 8th or 9th. Correct. Correct. So one is transverse wave. Okay, the other one is longitudinal wave. All right. So in transverse wave, the medium oscillates perpendicular to the wave velocity. Okay, in longitudinal waves, medium oscillates parallel to wave velocity. Fine. So EM waves, by the way, they are transverse. EM waves are never longitudinal. Fine. So all the EM waves are transverse. There are few mechanical waves that are longitudinal. Do you remember which one is the most popular longitudinal wave? Which one? Sound. No, water ripple is not longitudinal. Sound. Okay, this is a very good question. If it is an EM wave, then what oscillates? Medium is not there. You say the medium is transverse, then what is oscillating? Medium is not there at all. So how will you know that EM wave is a transverse wave? In electromagnetic wave, there is electric field that oscillates. Okay? Electric field is oscillating and wave is what? Traveling like this. There's a magnetic field also. I'm just oversimplifying it. So wave is going forward like that and electric field is oscillating like this. Understood? Electric field is doing up and down like that. Who asked that question? Understood? Okay. Great. So this is the classification. So now you have good amount of understanding what is basically a wave and what kind of wave exists. There is one very important thing about the wave. You can never pinpoint the location of a wave. Getting it? The wave will be spread in an area always. For example, if a particle is moving with velocity, you can exactly pinpoint that here is a particle. Here is this mass 1, 0, 2, 3. Particle is going from 1, 0 to 2, 3. But you can't say something like that for wave. Wave is present in entire medium. Okay, when water ripples are created, it is not that water ripples got created only at one location. It is spread in a zone. Fine. So you might have heard about Heisenberg uncertainty principle. Have you heard of it? From where that comes? Why it is there? Because the electrons behave like a wave. Okay, so if electrons start behaving like a wave, you cannot pinpoint the location of electron. You will have electron density. Basically, what is electron density? It is nothing but a wave. You say that in this zone wave exists, or in this zone electron exists. Fine. So anyways, we will discuss it more in class 12th. Right now, our focus is 11th curriculum. By the way, did you know that class 10th board exam will happen in the month of May or June? I think June. And class 12th board will also happen in the month of June. May or June. Okay. So, and what about your exams? Class 11th exam. Does that got postponed? No? Okay. As of now, March. Okay. Anyways, so let us first see how the chapter is organized. Okay. So, you know, I might be going little slowly, but then you know, initially we go very slow. Once everything fall in place, our pace will increase. Right now, we are just introducing the chapter. Write down waves. So waves topic can be this chapter. You can have multiple classifications in the chapter. Basically, four broad classifications. First one is kinematics of waves. Just like in simple harmonic motion, right? Same way, here also we have a section that talks about kinematics. Okay, so a wave equation will be given to you. You will be asked to find out the wavelength, frequency, time period, amplitude, and all those things. That is the kinematics of the waves. And we do not care. We do not care about how the wave got created, in which medium it is moving, and what is the effect of the medium on the wave. We don't care about all those things over here. Okay. Then we have the velocity of wave in a medium. Okay, so just to give you an analogy, just like when you travel in a car is your medium. So your velocity depends on the velocity of car, not your own this thing. Similarly, when a wave is moving in a medium, the velocity of the wave depends on the medium only. It depends on what kind of property the medium has. Okay, so we'll be discussing about how the medium affects the velocity of the wave and what is the equation. So you can say that second part is like laws of motion, where you try to get into the cause, what causes the wave to move, which is the medium. Okay. It's like, why do you think water ripples got created in the water only? When you throw the stone on the field, there are no ripples created. Okay. So medium has a big role. Then third part is the major section, which is superposition of the wave. So this is something big, superposition of waves, wherein you will learn about what will happen if two waves meet and both of the waves, it is like those, it is like the analog of the collision between the two masses. Similarly, you can say collision between the two waves, okay? So, and one interesting thing is that when two waves are traveling in the same direction, when they meet, they will behave differently. When two waves traveling in opposite direction meet, they will behave differently. When two waves having different frequency, when they meet, they will behave differently. Okay, so there is a wide spectrum of behavior that you need to understand. So that is why there are three things here. First is when wave, both the waves traveling in same direction. Okay. When both the waves travel in the same direction, a third wave gets created. All right. Then the wave, is space is less. Waves traveling in opposite directions. If wave is traveling in opposite direction, then something called standing waves gets created. Okay. Standing wave is a very common phenomena. Every musical instrument works on the standing wave only. Okay, so we will see how it gets created. Then you over here, our assumption is that frequency is same. Which need not be true, but then we are studying that only over there. Then waves having different frequencies, when they meet, what will happen? Okay, so something called beats will get created. So we will talk about these things under superposition of the waves. Okay, then the fourth section of the chapter is about Doppler's effect. Is anyone of your school is done with this chapter? YPR or HSR or DPS? Doppler's effect. So do any one of you remember what is the Doppler's effect? I think it was a small part was there in class 8. Doppler's effect is an apparent change in the frequency. The radar, sonar, okay? These equipments, which you might have heard of, radar and sonar, they work on the Doppler's effect only. So what will happen is that when you throw the wave forward and it hits an object and reflects back to you, there will be change in frequency. Suppose you have thrown 200 hertz frequency forward. It hits the object and comes to you, the frequency will be now 198 hertz. And the change in frequency depends upon the object's velocity, your own velocity. So if you know your own velocity, which might be at rest also, you will understand with what velocity the object is moving from where the frequency has hit and come to you. Okay, so Doppler's effect is very useful in radar and sonar. So this is what we are going to learn under Doppler's effect. Fine. Now you guys now might have a fair bit of idea that this is not a very small chapter. it is, but then it is not as big as RBD also. You can say that this is slightly bigger than the simple harmonic motion. Okay. And I have seen over the years that people like to ask a lot of questions from Doppler's effect. There are a lot of questions Doppler's effect. Then superposition of the wave comes next. Fine. So these two topics, a lot of questions are asked in competitive exams. But having said that, any point in time, they can surprise you with the questions from the other topics as well. Okay. Anyway, so this is a chapter. Let us now start the chapter only. Okay, so you might have a fair bit of idea how important the wave is in your day-to-day life, right? I don't need to emphasize it enough, because the sheer fact that we are having this class is because of wave. Okay, Wi-Fi is what? A radio wave which propagates and reaches your laptop or desktop or mobile phone. You are able to talk on the mobile phone because of the wave only, which get transmitted from the tower to your mobile phone. Okay, so wave is there everywhere. Every wireless technology works on the wave. Okay, so you cannot ignore the importance of it. Fine. Okay, so enough of introduction. We will now get down to the mathematics of the waves. So just like the simple harmonic motion, you remember how we started? We tried to find out what could be the equation which governs the simple harmonic motion, right? Similarly, we will try to see what is the equation that govern the a wave equation. Okay, but in SHM, the oscillation, the periodic motion, everything was very straightforward. We don't need to visualize too much. Okay, but here in waves, I feel that you need to visualize it a bit more. So what I'm going to do is a small exercise with you, and then we'll get back to the equation of the wave. Okay, so suppose there is a wave. There is a wave like this. Wave can be of any shape. Okay, it can be of any shape, any random shape. Fine. This wave is moving forward with velocity v. Okay, and this wave is moving on a string. Have you seen a wave on a string? Everyone, have you seen a wave on a string? What do you have to do? Just take a string, tie at one end, and move this up and down. This pulse will get created, start moving forward. So this is a disturbance that is moving forward. Okay, same thing. So what you need to tell me, this wave, which is moving forward, tell me after a small time, delta t, draw the shape of the wave. How the shape of the wave looks like. On this string only, after time delta t, draw the wave in delta t time. Done, all of you? Okay. Are Pranav, you are here? I thought you are struggling to join. Send me a message, na? Huh. So what will happen to the wave? Can anyone guess? What will happen to the wave? Wave as it is will move forward as it is. Understood? The blue one is after time t, after time delta t. Are you guys able to understand this, everyone? Disturbance is moving forward as it is. Whatever the shape of the disturbance, entire disturbance will just proceed forward. Okay? Now tell me, this point, this is, the string is taking the shape of the wave, right? The string is taking shape of the wave. So the point on the wave is point on the string also. This is how the string was earlier. This is how the string is later on. So point number one, point number two, point number three, four, and five. These are the five points on the string initially. Tell me, where are these points after time delta t on the blue wave? Where are they? Let me know once you're done. Done? Okay. So I think many of you have understood. I'll use this pink color. Point one will go down. Point two will go down. Point three moves up. Particles are moving up and down only. It reaches here. Point four reaches there. Point three reaches there. Point two goes down, point one goes down. So all the points, they have moved and took the shape of the blue curve. So the points on the string, they are moving up and down only, but it appears as if the disturbance has moved forward. I hope it is clear to everyone. No one has any doubt. Type in, is it clear? Okay, great. Fine. Now, if this thing is clear, we can talk about the wave equation. So this is my y-axis and this is my, let's say, x-axis, okay? So if I tell you at any point in time and at a location of x, if I tell you what is a y coordinate, what is a y coordinate if I tell you at every x and at every time t, does that describe the entire wave? Will you know everything about the wave if I tell you what is y coordinate at every x and every t? Is that sufficient? or you need to know something else. That is sufficient, right? So if you know, you are effectively telling me where the particle of the medium will be at every coordinate and at every time. Getting it? So this will be the wave equation. So a wave equation is basically nothing but y coordinate as a function of x comma t. Okay, anyone has any doubt, quickly type in, otherwise I'll proceed further. This should be the wave equation, right? Y coordinate, if I tell you, as a function of x and t, how does it play out? If you have to find out how the y coordinate changes at a particular location, let's say x equal to 2, put x equal to 2, and then for different times, you'll know what is the y coordinate of that x coordinate. Okay, so like that you can freeze t also. You can see that at t equal to 0, at t equal to 0, how y changes with x. Okay, so there is no other variable. There is only y, x, and t. Okay, now I'm going to ask you a very let's say critical question here. So think about it. I want you to tell me that, let's say this is the diagram. I'll just clear it a bit so that doesn't look clutter. Okay, so now let's say this is the y. This is the y from here to here. This is the y. This is x from here to there. It is x coordinate. All right. So this is the y coordinate at this location x and a particular time t. Getting it? So this is the y coordinate of this location whose x coordinate is x and time is t. Now I'm asking you that at t equals to 0, okay, at t equal to 0, where that red line was, okay, velocity of the wave is given to as v. Now tell me, the x coordinate. What is the x coordinate of that red line at t equal to 0? Its x coordinate is x at t equal to t. Let me know if you have not understood the question. Okay, Hariharan got it. Aditya got it. The question is that right now its x coordinate is x. So what would be the x coordinate of that red line at t equal to 0? In time t, how much the wave has traveled? In time t, the wave has traveled a distance of v into t. So this red line has moved what distance? The red line has moved a distance of v into t. Okay, the exact thing as it is moves forward. Now, when I say x comma t, I mean all the x coordinates, all of it. everything has moved by a distance of vt. Okay, so the x coordinate of a particular location, if it is x, okay, so at t equal to 0, the point was at a location of x minus vt, because vt is a distance traveled in time t. So before t seconds, it was behind by a distance of vt. Okay, so at t equal to 0, f of xt was actually f of x minus vt comma 0, which is your y. So y was f of x minus vt comma 0. Everybody understood this? Type in. Okay. Now, 0 is not a variable. 0 is just a constant. So you can say it is f of x minus vt. Fine. So the wave equation, although it is a function of x and t, it cannot be any function of x and t. It has to be a function of a combination of x and t, which is function of x minus vt. So what does it mean? Let's quickly discuss that. So we have, what I'm telling you is f of x minus vt function is the wave equation. So if you look at this ex by t square, this is a function of x comma t, but not a wave equation. Why? Because this is not a function of x minus vt. Whereas if I tell you e to the power x minus 2t divided by 2x minus 4t whole square, this can be written as x minus 2t divided by 4 times x minus 2t whole square. This is a function of x minus 2t. Getting it? Getting the difference? So this is the wave equation. Above one is the wave equation, and velocity of the wave is what? What is the velocity of the wave for this one? Velocity is 2 meters per second over here. 2 units. Correct. Fine. Clear? So we have, what we have understood is that the wave equation can be of any, it can look like anything as long as it is a function of x minus vt. It cannot be any function of x comma t. Does v need to be constant? No, v need not be a constant. Okay, v can change depending on the medium. If medium changes, for example, do you know that the light, when it travels inside the glass, its velocity changes? Do you know this? Light is a wave, right? So its velocity will change, right? Of course, it can change as a function of time. So medium should change as a function of time. It depends on the medium, Aditya. You need to understand that. The velocity doesn't depend on the wave. Doesn't matter what shape and size of the wave it is. You need to understand what is the property of medium. If medium keeps on changing after every few seconds, correspondingly your velocity will also keep on changing. Do not correlate it with mechanics. Okay. Fine. So basically your, this equation, function of x minus vt, is a wave that is traveling in positive x direction. Okay, then similarly, there is, let's say, if you write x plus vt, this is the wave that travel in negative x direction. Okay, so if it is x plus vt, it goes in the negative x direction. Minus x minus vt, it is positive x direction. Then shouldn't a sound wave reach any place? What do you mean by that? I didn't get you. Like if I shout. Oh, okay, okay. Understood, understood what you're saying. Hold on. All right, so basically the kind of wave which we have studied till now is one dimensional wave. Okay, wave can be of three types depending on how they are moving: 1D, 2D and 3D. Okay, because we are learning things for the first time, we have taken the most simplistic kind, 1D wave. Let's say on a string, there's a string on a straight line, wave is on the string only. It is 1D. 2D wave, can you give example of 2D wave, everyone? A wave travels in two dimension. Water ripples, correct? Okay, 3D wave, sound. Sound moves in three dimension, okay? So the equation of wave, you know, the equation of wave would be, it not only just depends on X, it will depend on Y and Z also. Okay, so sound is a 3D wave, but we are not talking about it right now. Understood, Pranav? Okay. Now, what is the next thing? So y is equal to f of x minus vt is the wave equation. All right. So basically, there is a sinusoidal wave. What is a sinusoidal wave? A sinusoidal wave is a wave that follows sine curve while moving. It can be sine, it can be cosine, because sine and cosine are exactly same, the shape of the curve. Okay, so going forward, our attention is this sinusoidal wave. Okay, so this equation represent a sinusoidal wave equation. A sine of, write down, kx minus omega t plus phi. This is the equation of a sinusoidal wave. Now, looking at this wave equation, can you tell me what is the velocity of the wave? Everyone, what should be the velocity of the wave? This should be function of x minus vt. So what is the velocity of the wave, everyone? Okay, Aditya and Pranav got it, Gayatri, Hari Aran got it. So basically, how will you write it like this, x minus vt format? How will you write it like this? You take omega, you take a k common, okay? You have to make the coefficient of x as 1. How will you do it? Like this, straightforward. Take k like this, it becomes x minus omega by k times t plus phi. right? So now this is what it is, x minus vt. So the velocity of the wave is omega by k. I hope it is clear to everyone how to find the velocity of the wave. Okay. A is called amplitude. Write down. A is the amplitude. The value kx minus omega t plus phi. This is the phase. Okay. So three things we have already found out: amplitude, phase, and velocity. Okay. So now let's study this equation a little bit more, because there are many things to find out from there. If you differentiate y with time, what exactly you'll get? Dy by dt will give you what? At a particular location x, as in x is fixed, you will get it as minus of a omega cos of, what is this? If velocity of the wave is omega by k, then if I differentiate, what I get? What it is? At a particular location, I'm keeping x fixed. I'm not differentiating x. My question is, if I differentiate y with time, what I get? Usually I get velocity, right? When I differentiate, you remember SHM equation, x is equal to a sine omega t plus phi. When you differentiate that, you get the velocity of the SHM. But here, velocity of the wave is already omega by k. You have found out. What do you get when you differentiate that? What is this? Who is moving in the y direction? Is the wave moving in the y direction? Who is moving in the y direction? Particles are moving in the y direction. Okay, so this will give you basically velocity of the particle. Okay, this is basically velocity of the particle only. Now a very interesting thing, if you find it interesting, Vp is equal to minus of a omega root over 1 minus sine square. I am writing cos theta as 1 minus sine square theta. Nothing great about it. This. Fine. Now I am. Okay, yes, correct. Now I am putting a inside the square root. So I get minus omega root over a square minus a square sine square kx minus omega t plus phi. What is a sine kx minus omega t? What is this? Y. This is y. So velocity of the particle is minus of omega root over a square minus y square. So can you recognize that this is an SHM equation? Okay, this is an SHM equation. So basically, what particles are doing? Particles are performing SHM if it is a sinusoidal wave. Okay, so write down, if it is a sinusoidal wave, particles perform SHM. And where's the mean position? Look at the equation. Can you tell me at what y the mean position lie? What is the y coordinate of the mean position? with mean position as y is equal to 0. So all the particle, it is not that just one particle, all the particles are doing SHM like that. Okay, and the mean position is the common this thing, a straight line. What does negative sign mean in VP? See, negative sign means that as the t increases, rather than moving up, it first goes down. That is what it means. Simple as that. It's like, you can see that there is a sine wave. It's a sinusoidal wave. Let's say starts like this. As it moves forward, how the wave will move? Wave goes like this. Okay, wave goes like this. So this particle, which was here, it went down rather than moving up. Okay, so that is a minus sign. Okay, so don't read too much on it. It's normal, it's okay. Clear? All right, so now we have understood few more things. We have understood that particles are doing SHM and the mean position is at y is equal to 0. Let us find out few more things. So if I again differentiate it, I'll get acceleration of the particle. And I don't need to differentiate it again and again, because if it is an SHM, acceleration of the particle would be omega square y, because oscillation is happening on the y axis. Okay, it can move up also depending on what is the value of phi. Okay, don't worry about it. This is a wave, sine wave moves forward. So where this particle go? This has to go down, na, in order to lie on the blue line. Okay, there are all these particles, they move down. All these particles move up. Okay, these particles move down. Okay, so we have learned about the fact that the particles are doing SHM. We have learned how to find the velocity of the particle. We have learned how to find the velocity of the wave. We know what is the amplitude. And what else? We knew something else. We know what is the phase. Okay. So now let's see if we can find out something else also. Again, write down this A sine kx minus omega t plus phi. Now, when we hear about the wave, what are the basic factors that come in our mind? Basic things. For example, when you hear SHM, basic thing that should come in your head is, what is the time period of SHM? What is the frequency of the SHM? So when you hear about the wave, what is the first thing that should come in your mind? Correct. Right? So there are few things that should come in your mind. And wavelength is definitely one of the things which will strike in your head. Okay, so let us first see what is wavelength. Wavelength means what? Can anyone describe what does wavelength mean? I will draw a sinusoidal wave here. What is a wavelength? Everyone should answer. I'm not asking a very difficult question, do I? What is the wavelength? Distance between two consecutive curves troughs and crests, two consecutive waves. Okay, time taken particle to complete ascension. It is a length, it is not time. Distance between the two particles. Okay, great. Okay, now till now we have been learning about the wavelength as distance between two consecutive crests and troughs. Like this is the wavelength, or this is the wavelength. Fine. So this is what we have learned, that wavelength is this. Now, why they are telling you this? Because it is easy for you to gauge what is a wavelength like this. But this is not a definition of the wavelength. Okay. This is how you measure the wavelength. Okay. The definition of wavelength is this. It is the minimum distance. Write down. Minimum distance along the line of velocity velocity of wave comma minimum distance between two points that are in phase. Now, can anyone tell me what does in phase means? In phase means what? Particles are doing SHM. In phase means what? Same time interval, okay. See, all the particles are moving up and down. Both have the same displacement y at the same instant. Okay. So can you tell me, are these in same phase? This point and this point, are they in same phase? These two? Point number 1, 2, 3, 4. Which one of them are in phase? It appears as if 1 and 2 are in phase, but they are not. In phase means, moving together. Okay, very layman words, moving together. Like you see two particles, they are simultaneously at the same level, moving up and down together like this. So if I look at the movement of the wave, wave move forward. Okay. This particle goes down. Two is moving up. So 1 and 2 are not in phase. Okay. Similarly, you can see that 3 is moving down. So 3 and 1 could be in phase. 4 is moving up. So 2 and 4 are in phase. 1 and 3 are in phase. Okay. So distance between 1 and 3 is the wavelength. Distance between 2 and 4 is a wavelength. Okay. And of course, if you talk about the crests, okay, both the crests, they will move down only. So both are in phase itself. So it makes sense to tell you when you were in a lower standard that distance between two consecutive crests or two consecutive troughs. If you look at the trough, they'll move up. They can't go down further because they're already at the lowermost. Okay, so this is the way the wavelength is defined. Now, definition is one thing, finding out is another thing. So if I tell you that this is the equation A sine of kx minus omega t plus phi. Achha, by the way, one more thing. We talked about the wavelength being the distance between two consecutive points having same phase. Tell me that with time things are changed. Okay, so with time, it is not that what I'm trying to say is that suppose you take two crests and two troughs. So this point will no longer remain crest after, let's say, few moments. This will go down. This will go down. So how will you pinpoint one location? You pinpoint a location by assuming what you're doing is you are taking at some fixed time, you take a snap of the wave. What I'm basically trying to say is you take a picture of the wave at a particular instant. Then on the piece of the paper, you look at the two points and find out the distance. It should not happen that while you're finding the distance, wave is already moving forward. Understood? At a particular instant, you need to freeze the wave and then look at it. I hope I've made myself clear here. So can you find out the wavelength from this equation? Find out the wavelength. Okay, Aditya got something. Others? Okay, that's okay. Let us try to do this. Suppose wavelength is lambda. Suppose wavelength is lambda, then whatever is the location y, whatever is the location y, same location should be there at k times x plus lambda. Because after every lambda, the phase should repeat itself. Do you all understand? Say these two should be equal. Yes or no? Type in. Everyone, type in. Yeah, what I'm saying that I'm saying lambda is a wavelength. So whatever is happening at x, same thing should happen at x plus lambda also, because the two points are in phase. So rather than x, I can write x plus lambda as well. So that is what I did. Fine. So I need to equate it to this. Now this I can write as a sine kx minus omega t plus phi plus 2 pi I can add, otherwise lambda will come out to be zero. And I can add 2 pi any number of times. Sine function is repetitive. So I will add minimum repetitive cycle, which is 2 pi. I can add 4 pi also. But 4 pi is like taking this crest and the other crest. You get 2 times lambda. Okay, I want minimum distance. So 2 pi I'm adding. So when you equate these two, you'll get k lambda to be equal to 2 pi. So from here, lambda will give you 2 pi by k. Okay. So if you write the wave equation like the way it was written, the wavelength would be 2 pi by k. Fine. K is, by the way, referred as wave number. Okay. All right. So we have got the wavelength also. Now the only thing left is frequency. In order to find frequency, we can find the time period and then take the inverse of it. So all of you, take this and find out the time period. What is the definition of time period, by the way? What is the time period definition? It is the minimum time. Minimum time taken by the particle to complete one oscillation. Find out. Can I repeat what I said? I have written everything, whatever I said. I was defining time period. Okay, Pranav got it. Others? Am I going very slowly? I somehow feel that I'm going a little slow. Tell me, is the pace fine? Should I increase the pace? Okay, so now, Now, if time period is capital T, then whatever was happening at t equal to small t, same thing should happen at small t plus capital T. So this A sine kx minus omega t plus capital T plus phi. Okay. These two are equal. If I directly equate it, I'll get capital T to be zero. So what I'll do, I'll add 2 pi and then equate. A sine kx minus omega t plus phi plus 2 pi. So from there, you get omega into capital T to be equal to 2 pi. So T is equal to 2 pi by omega. All right. So from here, the frequency is omega by 2 pi hertz. Okay. Minus. See, minus, you can add and subtract 2 pi. And time period cannot be minus, right? So even if you're getting minus, take a mod. So I can as well as subtract 2 pi. Now frequency is omega by 2 pi and wavelength is 2 pi by k meters. So you can see that frequency into wavelength is equal to the velocity of the wave. Okay, have you heard of this wave equation? For every wave, frequency into wavelength should give you the velocity of the wave. Everyone, have you heard of it? That frequency into wavelength should give you the velocity of the wave. Okay, so this is perfectly matching. These are the kinematics details of the wave. Let us now take one example from your textbook only. Okay, what we will do is that probably will our syllabus gets over one or two classes sooner, so we'll have a separate problem solving session of mains or advanced level for the waves. Right now the focus is school. Okay. Do it yourself. Don't open the book. Okay. Totally defeats the purpose else. Do this. Done. I think couple of parts are straightforward. You can tell me A. Amplitude is 0.005 meters. Okay. Anybody got wavelength? Lambda is 2 pi by k. K is what? K is 80 here. So you get pi by 40. Okay. Meters. C. Period T. 2 pi by omega, which is 2 pi by 3 seconds. Okay. Then frequency is 1 by time period. So 3 by 2 pi hertz. Okay. What else they're asking? Amplitude, period, wavelength. What is the speed of the wave? Speed of the wave is what? Omega by k, right? So 3 by 80 meter per second. This is the speed of the wave. Now, this one, the last part, try doing it yourself. Okay. No, not in terms of sine of an angle. You have to tell me the exact answer. Y is what? 0.005 sine of x equal to 0.3. 0.3 into 80 is 24 minus 60. So this is 0.005 sine of minus 36. What is sine of minus 36? Sine of minus 36 radians is how much? Can you find out without using calculators? It is in radians. Okay. It's in radians. So is 36 is too big an angle? Or it's a small angle. 36 radians is a huge angle. Okay, it's a big angle, very big. So what you have to do is bring it down between 0 to pi at least. How you bring it down between 0 and 2 pi? 0 and 2 pi, what do you do to bring it down? Sine has a period of 2 pi. So you can add 2 pi multiple times. You can add 2 pi multiple times. So you can keep on adding 2 pi multiple times. 2 pi is what? 2 pi is 2 into 3.14. So you can multiply 6 into 3.14. Not 6, actually 12. 12 into 3.14. How much it is? you can add 12 pi. How much is 12 into 3.14? Thirty-six point six eight minus 36 becomes 0.68. I hope this calculation is correct of yours. 0.68. 0.68 is how many times pi? Are you sure this is 36.68? I don't think so. Thirty-seven point six eight. So this is 1.68. 1.68 is roughly pi by 2. Yes or no? So this is 0.005 sine of pi by 2. Which is approximately 0.005. All of you understood this calculation? This calculation part is important. Type in, is it clear to everyone? Sir, should we add 2 pi? 2 pi he add kiya. You have added 2 pi 6 times. That is why 12 into pi. You added 2 pi 6 times. You can add as many times as possible. Type in, is it clear to everyone? Adrija, is it clear? Arjun? Okay. Fine. So let us move a little bit more. So we will now talk about, see, kinematics, again, kinematics of the wave is very similar to kinematics of the SHM. Okay, so we'll be taking few more questions, but let me finish the second part of the chapter also that talks about the velocity of the wave. Then probably we can take a lot more questions. Okay, write down the speed of a traveling wave. Why we are calling it as a traveling wave? Because there can be standing wave also. What is a standing wave? Have you seen in the guitar when you pluck the string, it just vibrates like that? Okay, that is a standing wave. It doesn't go anywhere. The speed of a traveling wave depends on, first of all, medium. And second, it also actually depends on whether it is transverse or longitudinal. Okay, these two things it depends upon. So let us try to see how it is related to the medium. Okay, once you tell me that it is a transverse wave, then it only depends on medium, right? So now, on which properties of the medium should the velocity of the wave depends upon? What do you think? What is the, how the medium should be, how the medium should be to support the propagation of wave? to support the wave propagation, how the medium should be? Medium should be dense, okay? So what the medium should do? Medium should do what? SHM? Medium should do SHM, okay? In order to do the SHM, what do you need? At the mean position, force is zero when it is oscillating, but it should still go down and move up even if force is zero. So inertia is required. If inertia is not there, then the particle won't do SHM, because as soon as force is zero, the particle stops. Because of inertia only, even though at the mean position force is zero, it keeps on going down. Okay, so inertial property of the medium will support the wave propagation. What else? What else? This is an important property of the medium. Another property of medium. Disturbance is, let's say here, I have started the disturbance here and somehow the wave has propagated and entire thing has started oscillating. How is that possible? How is it possible that this point got disturbed because of that point? Point number one and point number two. Two got disturbed because of one. The reason is elasticity. Good. So elasticity. Elastic property and inertial property. These are the two properties on which the speed of the sound, the speed of a wave will depend upon. There is no other thing. Okay. So let's take an example of transverse wave. On a string. Okay, so if I take an example of transverse wave on a string, then I need to take, let's say I can choose anything, right? I can say that mass will represent inertial property and strain will represent elastic property, or Young's modulus or bulk modulus will represent elastic property, anything. Okay, so it is up to me what to take. So it makes sense to take the inertial property of a string. You should not take the total mass of a string, because your string can be practically very big, so infinite mass. All right, so it's not the entire mass that matters. It is about how it is distributed. What is the density of the mass per unit length? Okay, represents the inertial property. Write down, inertial property is represented by mass per unit length, which you can say is mu. Okay, mu, if you see this mu, coefficient of friction will come in your mind. But then we take mu here as well. Now for elastic property. When we talk about the string, what is the first thing which will come in your mind with respect to mechanics? With respect to mechanics, what is the thing? Tension, T. Okay, so elastic property is represented by tension, T. Now, some of you will be like, how it is related to elastic property, from where this comes from? The fact is that we say that the string is inextensible and all those things. But if a string is inextensible, tension will never come. Okay, because there is a strain in the string, that is why there is a stress in the string. Stress in the string is represented by the tension only. Okay, but that small strain is negligible. So I can very well say that tension can represent the elastic property. Okay, so now the velocity of the wave depends on mu and t. I hope till now everything is clear. I want you to use dimensional analysis. Please use dimensional analysis and come up with the equation. Do the dimensional analysis. You know, right, how to do the dimensional analysis? Okay, Pranav Dharmagadi got something. Did you get your physics UT marks from the school? How was it? Okay, so velocity is proportional to, how you do it? Mu to the power A and T to the power B. Like this we do dimension analysis, right? I can say that velocity depends on mu and T like this. So dimensionally, I can write down this dimensional equation L T minus 1. This is equal to dimension of mu is what? Mass per unit length, ml minus 1 raised to power a. Tension is force, mass and acceleration. So ml t minus 2. So this can be written as m a plus b l b minus a t to the power minus 2b. Okay, so if I compare it, minus 2b is equal to minus 1. From here, b is equal to half. And coefficient of mass, a plus b should be 0. So a should be equal to minus b, which is minus half. Okay, so then you can check coefficient of L. Is b minus a minus 1? Okay, B minus A is not minus, oh sorry, I don't have to check that. That is coefficient of T. T is minus 2B that we have already equated. B minus A should be equal to 1. And yes, it is 1. So it matches. So B is equal to half and A is equal to minus half. So V is proportional to mu to the power minus half and t to the power half. So from here, you'll get velocity being proportional to root over t by mu. Okay. And you'll get with proportionality constant c under root t by mu. And experimentally, and surprisingly, it is found out that c is equal to 1. So velocity is root over t by mu. Is this clear to everyone? Anyone has any doubt, quickly type in. No doubts? Okay. Let's take few questions on it. So I have, let's first take the school textbook thing. Find out the answer, okay? All of you do this. This is from your school textbook, a direct formula substitution. You have to do it, okay? You cannot be lazy to not to do it. Okay, Pranav got something. Others, all of you should get the answer. Roughly, you can tell the answer, if not exactly. You can tell between this and that the answer. Okay. Right now, if four options are there between 84 and 96, you've taken a big range. Okay. I think it's a direct this thing. I don't need to discuss much on it. Mass is given, a steel wire of this length is there. So first, what you do, you find out the mass per unit length. That is 5 into 10 raised to the power minus 3 divided by 0.72. Okay, this is mu. Tension is 60 newtons. Okay. So the velocity is root over T by mu. Direct substitution. T by mu. When you divide it, 0.72 will go in the numerator. Now don't expect me to tell you how to multiply and divide. I'll directly write down the answer, which is 93 meter per second. Okay. Let's take a couple of more numericals. So there is a string, okay? The string has mass per unit length as mu. Okay, mu is the mass per unit length. This length of the string is L. This length is L. Mass per unit length is mu. And capital M is actually very large compared to the mass of the wire. So don't worry about taking this mass, including that mass. It is negligible. Okay. Now what is given to you is that this entire thing is accelerating upwards. With acceleration of A, you are basically inside the lift. This entire setup is there inside the lift, and lift is accelerating with A upwards. What you do is that you disturb the wire here little bit. You just plugged it like a guitar string, and this disturbance starts moving. This disturbance is moving from this end to that end. You need to find out how much time the disturbance will take to go from here, point A to point B. Find out. Time taken by the disturbance or the pulse to go from A to B. Yeah, this has mass. I'm telling you to ignore this mass, because mass which is hanging is very big. Okay, Aditya got something. Did you get the value of tension on the string? How much is the tension on the string? Draw the free body diagram here. This is T, this is Mg, correct. Mg, this mass is actually accelerating. It is accelerating with acceleration A, right? So I can write down T minus Mg is equal to M into A. I am getting T as M times G plus A. Okay, this is the tension T and the velocity of the wave is root over T by mu. T by mu, this is velocity. That's all. I mean, once you get the velocity of the wave, the time taken will be L divided by velocity. So this is the answer. Okay. This I think came, sir, what is mass not, what do we find T? What if mass, this mass, if you don't ignore, you find out tension here. Tension here will be equal to tension there. Okay, nothing different it will be. This mass is, let's say, small m. Then your tension over there will be equal to m plus a small m into g plus a. That's all. That's the only change. We can take tension constant. Yes, tension is constant. Why not? Tension is a constant. See, there is no variation of tension due to gravity on this horizontal string. Gravity is vertical. Okay. Any other doubt anyone has? There's no variation. The pulse will go from here to here only. I don't care about movement of the disturbance here. Okay. No, Pranav. If you consider the pulse moving on this, then yes, tension changes and velocity will also change as you go from here to there. Okay, but throughout this string, even if you don't ignore mass, tension will be constant. You're assuming the string to be horizontal, which it cannot be if there is a mass. The string cannot remain horizontal, but hypothetically we are assuming. Clear? Let us take one example of variation in the velocity. I can see that some of you are constantly asking about that thing. So let's take this final example before we take a break. There is a string which is hanging like this. Okay. A uniform mass density string. Total mass of the string is M and length of the string is L. Okay. It is hanged from one of its ends like this. What you do is that you create a small disturbance at the bottom. This disturbance will move up. Okay. You need to find out how much time it will take for the disturbance, time taken by the disturbance to go from bottom to the topmost point. Find out. To go from bottom to the topmost point. tension is constant or it keeps on changing? Everyone. Tension constant. How it is constant? When you hang yourself from hand like this on a, let's say on a rod, you feel maximum tension where? On legs or on hands? Where you feel the maximum tension? On hands. So tension is changing. It is not constant. Okay. So if tension is changing, what you can do is that you can find out tension as a function of x. Distance from here is, let's say, x. At a distance of x, can you tell me what is the tension over there? All of you? How much is the tension over there at a distance of x? Okay, Aditya got something. Others? Okay. Just draw the free body diagram. Right? Take that much piece of the rope and show the forces. That's all. How much is the mass of this much? X length mass is how much? M by L into x. This is the mass of this portion, that into g, and this is t. It is in equilibrium. There is no acceleration anywhere, so you can write down t minus m by l x g is equal to zero. So t is equal to m by l g times x. Do you all understand this? This is T. All of you understand this? Type in. So velocity is what? Velocity is root over T by mu. So at this location, velocity is T by mu. So M by L, GX. Mu is how much? What is mu? Mu is M by L only. So good thing is M by L gone. So velocity is root over gx. Okay. So then how will you find time taken for this pulse to go from this point to the topmost point? What to do next? We can write v as dx by dt. Dx by dt is root over gx. Fine. So dx divided by root x is equal to root g into dt. What is the integral of dx by root x? Dx by root x, what is the integral? 2 root x or 1 by 2 root x? What is this integral? X to the power minus half dx integral is x to the power minus half plus 1 divided by minus half plus 1. So it is 2 root x. Okay. Don't make such errors. So 2 root x, when you put the limits, it becomes 2 root L. This is equal to root of g t. So time taken will be 2 times of root of L by G. So this is how you can deal with the change in the velocity. And there is no point finding the acceleration of the wave. Why there is no point? Because wave is not a mass. For a mass, if you find acceleration, you can apply Newton's second law and say force is equal to mass times acceleration. But over here, even if you find acceleration of a wave, there is no mass. You can't say mass and acceleration is something. There is no physical meaning of the acceleration of the wave. So we don't focus on it. We focus on the velocity for a wave. Fine. So let's take a break now. We will take a break and we will meet. Wave has acceleration. Why not? This don't you think this is accelerated? V is equal to root gx. Is it constant velocity? It can accelerate, but acceleration has no physical significance. So that's why we don't care about it. All right, so all of you, we will meet at 6:27 p.m. Come back in time. Fine, so let us move forward with something new. We have discussed about the transverse wave on the string, all right? Now let us discuss about the longitudinal wave, okay? Longitudinal wave. Little bit of discussion is required first on the equation of it, okay? Because whatever discussion we had, we always assume that we are talking about the transverse only. Longitudinal wave, slightly different from the transverse wave, because in the transverse wave, the oscillation happens on the y-axis and the wave travels on the x-axis like this, okay? Oscillations are happening like that. So this is transverse. In the longitudinal, what happens is that these are the particles, let's say, particles of the medium, they are oscillating like this. Okay, the oscillations happen on the x-axis itself and the wave also propagates on the x-axis. There's a velocity wave also. Oscillations also happen like that and velocity also like this. So I'll just show you a small demo of the longitudinal, 1D longitudinal wave. It'll be clearer then. So spring wave. See, look at this. You can see that, all of you, how wave is traveling. Disturbance is moving in the same direction. In the direction of the oscillation of the particle. Particle here is this spring. This is all slingy, right? Fine, so this is the small demo of how longitudinal, 1D longitudinal wave will be, okay? So the equation of the transverse wave, when we write like this, A sine of kx minus omega t plus phi. How do you think you can write down equation for the longitudinal wave? There is nothing on the y-axis. So you can't write y is equal to something for longitudinal. Then what you write instead of y? Instead of y, you write x, but x is here, na? X is the x coordinate. What is y over here? Can you tell what is y here? You can say y coordinate. Okay, fine. That is y coordinate. But physically, what it is? What does y represent physically? Distance from the, correct, distance from the mean position. Mean position. Now, with the transverse wave, the good thing is that mean position lie on the y is equal to zero for all the particles. Mean position is y is equal to zero. Okay. Over here, the mean positions for the longitudinal wave will be at different locations. So these are the mean positions. X coordinate is different and oscillation is happening on the X coordinate only. So here also, there should be something that represents distance from the mean position. It cannot be X coordinate because the mean position of the X coordinate itself is different. So we say that S is a variable which tells us distance from the mean position for that particle. So S is equal to A sine KX minus omega T plus phi. Okay. Now, if we plot, rather than plotting the wave like this, if we plot on the y-axis S, rather than the y coordinate, if you plot S and this is X, you will see that it looks exactly same as the transverse wave. Okay, but then this is not y-axis, it is distance from the mean position. All right, so mathematically, both the equations are same. Both the equations, mathematically, they are same. So whatever we do going forward with respect to the transverse wave, same thing is valid for the longitudinal also, keeping in mind that we are taking S instead of Y. Is this clear to everyone? Type in, is it clear to everyone? Okay, so the most common form of the longitudinal wave is the sound wave only. Okay, so we can find out the speed of sound as well, which is of our interest. Okay, but before we do that, let's try to find out what is the equation for the longitudinal wave. And you know, the basic difference between longitudinal and transverse wave is that transverse wave usually, I mean, most of the time is on the surface. Okay, because the particle have to move up and down. All right, at the boundary, this transverse wave comes. Longitudinal wave is usually inside the medium. One is on the medium, other is inside the medium. Okay, so it's like if you talk about the surface of the water level, on the surface there can be transverse wave, water ripples will be there, but inside the water ripples cannot be there. But if wave exists, it will be longitudinal wave. Okay. Similarly, when I'm speaking, let's say I'm talking to someone. Okay. So I will disturb the particles which are near my mouth. When I speak, I disturb those particles, and that disturbance will propagate and then it reaches your ears and you hear that. Okay. So that is the physics related to the how you hear it. Once it goes inside your ear, it is biology. We'll not discuss that. So depending on which medium you are, your sound quality will also differ. If you are in a vacuum, you'll not be able to talk. because there are no particles to propagate the sound waves. It needs medium to propagate. Okay, if you inhale helium and then try to speak, you'll see that your voice will be completely changed. Okay, so depending on medium, your sound will be different. How longitudinal wave converted to transverse wave? It's a disturbance only. It can get, it will disturb the longitudinal wave, can reach the surface of the water, and on the surface, same energy will get converted into the transverse wave as well. Okay. Okay, so now let us talk about, we have seen the transverse wave equation on a string. Okay, let us see the longitudinal wave, what is the velocity of it, on what it depends on. So one thing which we all agree on is that longitudinal wave is inside the medium. You are immersed inside. Like I am immersed in the room which has gas, oxygen, nitrogen, some dust particles. So inside the medium I am, and then I am speaking. So that's how longitudinal wave works. So like we already discussed, the velocity depends on the medium, and there should be some elastic property. Elastic property, and there should be some inertial property of the medium. What do you think inertial property should, what parameter suits best once you are, let's say, inside the medium? Which inertial property will be best suitable? In a string, it was mass per unit length. What do you think here? Density, right? Volume density, rho. It is volume density. Okay. Elastic property is taken by the bulk modulus B. Bulk modulus. We are talking about fluids here. Okay. So can you find out if velocity depends on the bulk modulus B to the power A and rho to the power B? Then use dimensional analysis, find out the equation of the velocity of the wave. All of you. Do you know what is the formula for the bulk modulus? Do you know this? B is what? Delta P divided by delta V by V minus. This is the bulk modulus formula. Okay, Pranav got something. See, dimension of bulk modulus is the dimension of pressure only. Delta V by V dimension is zero, nothing. It is a ratio between the two volumes denominator. Anybody else? velocity is LT minus 1. Aditya also got it. Pressure is force per unit area. So ML minus 1 T raised to power minus 2. Power A, density is mass per volume. This will be M A plus B L minus A minus 3B. You should have done it yourself instead of waiting for me to do this. Okay, it is, if you're just copying it, it is as good as you're copying from a book. It is, I don't know, it doesn't help, okay? So minus 2A is equal to minus 1. So A is equal to half. A is equal to half and A plus B should be equal to 0. There is no M here. So B should be equal to minus half. Now I have to check whether this is valid for L also. Is minus A minus 3B equals to 1? Is minus A minus 3B is equal to 1? If it is, then these are the correct ones. You can see here, minus A minus 3B. So this is 1 only. Okay, so it works. So A is half and B is minus half. So velocity is under root B by rho into some constant. And surprisingly, the constant of proportionality is 1 experimentally. C is equal to 1. So velocity is root over B by rho. Okay. Now, this is the velocity of the longitudinal wave inside a medium. So using this, can I find speed of sound in our atmosphere? Okay. The answer is, of course, yes. That is why I have written this thing. So now if it is yes, then, you know, density of the air is 1.29 kg per meter cube on the surface of the earth, approximately. But the bulk modulus is not given to you. Okay. So can I find bulk modulus, which is equal to minus of delta P by delta V by V? So in a differential form, it can be written as minus V dP by dV. Do you all understand what I'm trying to do here? Everyone, have you understood till here, whatever I am done? Okay, so let us try to find out the bulk modulus of the of this process in which sound is traveling. Okay, so there is one assumption we need to make, what kind of process it is, because for different processes, bulk modulus is different. Okay, for example, in an ideal gas, if you talk about that process of traveling of the sound is isothermal, then V into dP by dV will be different. If you say that it is adiabatic, then V into dP by dV will be different. So depending on the process, bulk modulus will be different for the same gas. Please write down. Depending on the process, B is different for same gas. It is not a constant of a gas. It is a constant of gas and the process. Which process it is. So we need to assume something. So Newton was studying it. Newton is here also. So Newton assumed that it's a isothermal, it's an isothermal process. Okay. The propagating of the sound, propagation of sound is isothermal process, and it sounds very reasonable that of course it has to be isothermal. The temperature should not change of the atmosphere. So everything is happening at a constant temperature only. So pressure into volume should be a constant C. So if this is true, if it is isothermal process, P into V is a constant, can you tell me what is the bulk modulus for an isothermal process? Minus V into dP by dV should be what? Find out. Anyone? The hint is differentiated with respect to volume. Okay, Aditya got it. Others? Nobody else? Isko differentiate karo. This you differentiate with respect to volume. What is the derivative of a constant? Zero. So right hand becomes zero. Only Aditya got it. Okay, so if we differentiate with respect to volume, then I'll have P plus V dP by dV is equal to zero. So from here, minus of V dP by dV is equal to P. So bulk modulus is the pressure itself if it is an isothermal. All of you understood this? Is this clear? That bulk modulus is P, the atmospheric pressure. Type in, is it clear? All of you, go through it. Differentiation for a minute. Differentiation. इसमें क्या सी P into V is a constant. When you differentiate, first you differentiate V. What is the derivative of V? dV by dV. Then you differentiate P. So it's a chain rule, right? You have learned it in the bridge program. This is equal to zero. So dV by V is one. P plus V dP by dV is zero. That is what it is. Any other doubt? Is there a lag? Pranav is facing lag. Pranav, always you face lag. Huh? Maybe some internet issue at your end, maybe. Okay. There is no lag. All right, so this is P. Now, velocity of the longitudinal wave is under root of B by rho. So velocity of sound is what? In the atmosphere, it is atmospheric pressure divided by density of the atmospheric gases. So if you substitute the values, atmospheric pressure is what? 1.01 into 10 raised to power 5 divided by density of the gas is around 1.29. This should be the velocity of the sound, okay? And this comes out to be 280 meters per second. Okay, this is what Newton calculated, and during that point in time, I guess there was no sophisticated instruments to exactly find out whether it is experimentally correct, but given the reputation, it was assumed that this is correct. But later on, people found out that this is not the correct value of the speed of sound. So there is something wrong. And if there is something wrong, what it would be? The assumption would be wrong, okay? And what was the assumption? That it is an isothermal process, right? The formula cannot be wrong, formula is correct. But when we write B is equal to P, we are assuming it to be an isothermal process. But it is not so. So Laplace came with its correction. Write down. This is a Laplace correction. He told that the travel of sound wave is a rapid process. And no time to exchange heat. And hence, what is the process then? Hence, the process is, what kind of process it should be? The process is closer to adiabatic. Okay, and if it is an adiabatic process, then P into V is not constant. P into V raised to power gamma is a constant. Okay, now I want you to do exactly the same exercise as just now and tell me what is the bulk modulus now. Find out bulk modulus is what now? If this is true, as in adiabatic process. Anyone? Okay. So Aditya got something. Others? Just differentiate it with respect to volume. Okay, Advik got it. Anybody else? Nobody else. Only Advik and Aditya got it. Okay. Some more time. 30 seconds. Okay, so now if I differentiate it, I will get P into gamma into V to the power gamma minus 1. I'm applying chain rule. Okay, differentiating V to the power gamma, and then I will differentiate P. So V to the power gamma dP by dV is equal to 0. Okay, so I can cancel out this from here, so V will remain. So V dP by dV is equal to minus of gamma P. So minus of that is plus gamma P, okay? So bulk modulus is gamma times P, fine. So can you tell me gamma for the atmosphere? Gamma is what? For the atmospheric gases. Everyone. What kind of gas the atmosphere has largely? Diatomic. So what is gamma for diatomic? Seven by five. Okay, correct, 7/5. So now using this correction, if I use the formula, will become gamma P by rho. Bulk modulus is gamma P. So this is under root of 7/5 into 1.01 10 raised to the power 5 divided by 1.29. Okay, this comes out to be 331 meter per second. This is much closer to the actual value. Okay, all of you have understood till now? Laplace correction, everybody understood? Are you guys facing difficulty in differentiating it? I didn't get what kind of problem you guys are facing. Is clear, right? All of you. Okay, so this is the basic theory of the kinematics and the, let's say, the velocity of the wave, how you will find out. Okay. Of course, we'll have a problem solving session in which we'll discuss a lot of problems. Right now, since we have only, let's say, half an hour, I'll just introduce to you superposition. Okay, little bit of that.